Hey, what? Don't take the lens cap off. This is common sense when making videos. Hey, what's up, garden friends? Jeff here, Tropical Plant Party. How's everybody doing? I hope you're good. I'm great. Working in between storms, things are gonna be a little bit blustery. I apologize in advance for background noise. This is a very last minute decision video. I wasn't going to film this and I thought, oh, why not? Because Saturday's video isn't really going to be a vlog, so I thought let's just hang out for a bit while I plant some stuff up and have a little, not midweek vlog, because this will be Thursday when this comes out. You get what I'm saying, but just, I'm gonna plant some stuff up. I have these windmill palms here, one of them more sad than the other. This one over here got sent to me covered in scale. So that's something I've been working on treating. For the most part, eradicated the scale. It has soft scale and hard scale. So that's fun. They're not completely identical, which is something I prefer with urns, but finding two identical palms sometimes is a bit tricky. So I'm not going to get too hung up on that. I think that over time, with their trunk's heights being about the same, I think they'll even out. There's a mess back there. Like I said, this is a vlog. I'm working on stuff right now. So what I'm going to do here is get these planted up. And see, I already have the, no, you can't see. I already have the bottoms lined with some packing peanuts. These pots have really tiny drainage holes in them. And I would make them bigger, but there's not much space. So I decided to just leave the little drainage hole and use the packing peanuts. In years past, I have put lots of different things in these pots. I've had arborvitaes so that they would be perennial. I've had some, what were they, banana trees last year, which were very pretty. I decided to go with the windmill palms this year and hopefully for the next several years because they can stay outside. I'm in zone 6A, 6B, I live right on the line. They'll be able to stay outside for the majority of the year, probably 10 months out of the year, and they'll be on my front porch next to my front door, so when it gets really cold, I can just pick them up, pull them inside into the house, and bring them back out when temperatures warm back up. Since they're in containers, I'll probably pull them in whenever temperatures drop below 20 for the first year, and ultimately, they can go much colder than that. I'm talking Fahrenheit, but I want them to have a few years to adjust. I don't want to just leave them outside when it's like 15, 10 degrees outside when, I mean, they came up from Miami. They're not used to that. I went ahead and blended up some soil. This is just an all-purpose potting mix. I added a nice rich compost to it. It has sand and earthworm castings and some bark chips and lots of good things in there. It'll help enrich the potting mix that I'm using. And I've already filled these up, so I just gotta drop these in there. See, I'm not going to do too much to mess with the root balls. I don't think I need to. Go play around with it a little bit, make sure that's the right level. Yeah, that's too low. The soil compacts. Sometimes that happens. No big deal. Just pull it out and put a little bit more soil in there. I don't need very much. Just a little bit. Yeah, that's better. I want to make sure that it's high enough so if I put any spillers in here, they're going to be able to come over that edge without having to creep up and crawl over. And I don't want the base of these trunks to be sunk down in any kind of manner where water could end up collecting around them. Usually isn't that big of an issue with potted plants. Just be safe, I want to make sure it's kind of up a little bit more. Okay, so now I've gone ahead and filled these up the rest of the way. The only thing I didn't show that might be noteworthy is that when I fill in around the root ball, then I tend to add some continuous release fertilizer to that mix. The stuff that's down below, there's already some continuous release, but I add a good amount more to what's actually going to go around the root ball. There's a little bit down below, but when you think about what's going on here with continuous release fertilizer, you water, it releases, it leaches out, gets near the roots, but ultimately gravity is a thing. So I don't see a reason to waste a lot of fertilizer of that continuous release pellet for what's going down below when a lot of that's going to wash down. And then there's already some in that mix as it is. And I just get to the part where I go, oh, hey, my eyes are bigger than my planters. Well, let's see how much I can fit into these pots. This was the plan from the beginning. I honestly really didn't realize how large the root balls were going to be on these windmill palms. I figured that they were somewhat over potted because they felt a little bit loose in my hands, but no, they're rooted in pretty solid, mostly this one. That doesn't matter. I just kind of want to start sticking plants in here and having fun with everything. And I need to hurry. This video needs to come out today on Tuesday. I think I said Thursday earlier. I meant Tuesday. So if there's an abrupt ending here, then pick up where we left off on another day. I'm gonna start from the back and work my way forward. I wanna make sure I have some purple in the back behind all those oranges and pinks. I'm gonna want some of the Snow Princess Euphorbia intermingled behind those impatiens so it'll grow up through them. It'll add a lot of texture. And of course the impatiens, that's important. It's the the big color impact for everything. I'm gonna go pink, orange, and then spillers. I'm just gonna do it and come right back. This rain's gonna start coming down any minute. Okay, that was a very brief storm, and as soon as it ended, whatever that sound is, started. I'm sorry, it's been going on for like 40 minutes. It doesn't seem to want to stop. I have no idea what it is. Just gonna push through it. So these looked a lot better before we had a sudden downpour. So the thing with double impatiens, that's what is in here. I'll go through all the plants here in just a minute. Unless you keep their root ball pretty... Oh, it stopped. Okay, that's nice. Unless you keep the root ball nice and firm, you don't disturb it too much. Usually they look a little bit ratty when you get them planted up. So, you know, in a week or two, these will look a lot better. Probably not even that long, actually. Maybe just within a few days, they'll start to look very nice and very full. So what I did here is I alternated these Rockapoco orange impatiens with Rockapoco coral reef. I have the tags here so you can actually get a look at what those are. So it's a pink and an orange. I think it's kind of funny that they came up with a clever name for this one and the other one's just orange. It's hard to be creative all the time. I'm not going to be hard on them for that. But the Rockapoco orange has a really nice kind of a creamy light orange color to it. And then the coral reef, which is, I mean, all of them are kind of hiding a little bit because their flowers are down from the rain and being potted up and everything. Get in a little bit close on some of these. Hopefully you can see. Have a really nice kind of a hot pink flower to them. I think that they go very well with the orange. And then in the back on each side, there are two of these Endless Illumination. Can you guys read that? Is it too dirty? Endless Illumination. These are Borrelias right here. 12 to 16 inches high, which is kind of right in there with this, not, I keep wanting to say sun impatience, with the double impatience. These are 10 to 20 inch. Ew, more noise. Nice color combo. All part shade to shade. I'm going to talk about the lighting with this planter here in just a minute because it's going kind of a unique area. And then I was going to put two of these in each one of the planters, but I just don't think that I need to. These are Diamond Snow Euphorbias. If you've ever grown the Diamond Frost Euphorbia before, then you know that these have really great airy texture. They'll work their way up through the foliage on the other plants in here, and they have just these beautiful nice white flowers. This is the Diamond Snow. The flowers seem to be much more abundant and closer together than on the Diamond Frost. The Diamond Frost is a little bit longer and a little bit more leggy looking, really. But otherwise, as far as the size and everything else goes between the Diamond Snow and the Diamond Frost, it seems to be pretty much the same. But you can't see them yet. You can kind of see it in there, but it hasn't, you know, it'll have to grow up and come through everything. That'll take some time. These Euphorbias, they are such good growers. I was like, yeah, I think if I just have one inside each one of these, that should be enough to come up and give that airy texture and that nice white flower that I was hoping to see. I think that two would have been overkill, and it would have been really hard to work it in there because there wasn't a ton of space to work with in these pots. Could have scooted the windmill palms back to the edge, but I really want them centered because they'll be able to stay in these pots for a few years. In the front, any of these flowers facing the camera? Doesn't look like it. These are purple wave petunias. They're just purple wave petunias, not a special variety, just nice light purple colors. I think it goes very well with the pink and the orange. And then in the very front, looking a little bit sad, I'll explain why in just a moment. These are Marguerite Dwarf sweet potato vines. The sweet potato vines, I've talked about in other videos how I enjoy them, but they just get a little bit too big for me with, you know, standard plantings. They really need to go in something big to accommodate their size. According to the tag here, if you'll be able to see that, if not, doesn't matter, I'm gonna read it to you. It says they'll get 6 inches tall and they'll trail 12 inches. That's nothing for a sweet potato vine. So if that's true, then I'm going to be able to have that nice, fun foliage that you get from a sweet potato vine. It's this nice light green color on the Marguerite variety. That's going to go great with the purple and the pinks and the oranges in the background, but it's not going to just cover the entire pot. That's an issue I've had with these planters before, was whether or not I wanted to put something in them that was going to come over and trail aggressively, because these have this little design on the front and I would kind of like for the center to be up a little bit higher. So if these only trail down a foot, that's going to be right around here, and I'm sure I'll have to prune and keep them tidy. Not a big deal though, because annuals, you know, they're going to need a midsummer cutback anyways. And they're just sturdy growers, like the color of the foliage, like the shape of the foliage, and they grow quickly. They're looking a little bit rough because I noticed as I was planting them that each one of these had two plants in them. So I decided to keep those two divisions so that I have some more to work with. They need to be watered. I haven't watered these yet. By pulling those out, it messed the roots up a little bit more. Mostly on this one over here. The other one's not as bad. It's okay. They're tough. They'll adjust to it. The only thing I haven't done here that I had thought about doing was getting something going in the back, like a coleus or some caladiums, something like that. I'm going to give it a little bit of time and think on that because I have a few all-white caladiums that I think would look really pretty as a backdrop to this, but I have to decide if this is where I want to use those. These are planted close together. They're annuals. It's okay. They'll blend together and the colors will start to blend nicely and they'll look pretty good. The thing that I wanted to hit on here is you may notice that there is something going on here as far as compatibility that might seem kind of off. And that's right here, the wave petunias and those impatiens. Everything else I have planted up in these is part shade to shade. Where these are going on in my house, the front porch, is like right in the sweet spot from where I can grow plants that like shade to like part sun. I mean, not all plants. But last year I noticed that I had sun impatiens in these and some super petunia vistas, and they did wonderfully. And 6 feet in front of those, getting even more light in my landscaping, I had just regular impatiens growing, and they did wonderfully also. So these are going in a spot where they're going to get very bright morning light for a few hours, and then it'll be filtered throughout the rest of the day. Yeah, so like I said, these are kind of going right in that sweet spot for the part shade to part sun plants. Wave petunias, I don't know if they're going to do as well as a super petunia vista does in a part sun location or even a part shade location. Super petunia vistas tend to just kind of grow no matter where you put them. They can get long and leggy looking. They're not going to look as pretty with less light as they would with full sun. But the wave petunias, yeah, like I said, I don't know if they're going to do that. I have some wave petunias that I planted in a shady spot, oh, I don't know, a month or so ago, a slightly shady spot. And they've been doing okay, so it's just going to be a matter of sitting back and seeing how they do. It's sort of an experiment with those. If it turns out there's not enough light there for them, then I can swap them out with some purple lobelia, and I think that will look totally fine, and actually even better. I just haven't been able to find purple lobelia. I can only find the blue, and I would prefer more of a deeper, richer purple tone. And really, with these sweet potato vines that are going to come over the front, I think these will look nice even without a purple trailer, but I would prefer to have that purple mixed in there because the brawlalias that are back there, they have really pretty purple flowers on them. None of them really have significant flowers on them right now to show you, but that will be a nice backdrop to the orange and the pink, and I'm just now noticing the storm pulled one of those down. I gotta fix that. That cute little purple flower in there, do you see it? I can't see my camera. You can kind of see the cute little dainty purple flowers that those will get, and they'll be just slightly higher than the impatiens, and that's assuming that the impatiens get their midsummer cutback, which they'll need. Impatiens get pretty scraggly looking sometimes if they don't get that cutback. Yeah, that's everything. They'll fill out and look better. And just, you know, like I said, a couple days they'll look better, but they'll really start to look their best within a couple of weeks. And then I'll figure out what I'm going to put in the background there. These are going to be up against the wall. Won't be able to see them from all directions, so I wasn't concerned about taking the pattern all the way around them. I don't think that's necessary. But I did still want to keep the windmill palm centered in here because, like I said, they will be in these pots for up to 3 years. I don't think I'd want to push them past that. Every single year, I will pull the soil off the top just a few inches and top dress it with some nice, rich, fresh soil to keep things nice and healthy down below in the root system. And I'll have them outside the majority of the year. For the first year, I think I mentioned this, when temperatures drop below 20 to 25, I'll pull them in. I'm talking Fahrenheit. And then the next year, I'll let them go to 20 or 15, keeping an eye on them. And then ultimately, I won't let them go below probably 15 to 10 degrees Fahrenheit, just because they don't grow very fast. And they're kind of pricey plants, at least where I live. So I prefer to preserve as much of the foliage as possible. They grow a lot more quickly in the ground, but again, they're kind of pricey. So they're not plants that I like to take the gamble on in zone 6. Some people grow them in zone 6. They're considered cold hardy. I would say that's true solidly into zone 7, zone 6. You're rolling the dice. A lot of it has to do with your soil, where they're located, where you live, and your climate. There are a lot of variables that factor into how hardy a plant is. But I would say the Trachycarpus fortunae, which is just your standard windmill palm, solidly hardy zone 7B, zone 7A, maybe, depends on, you know, your, like, all the things I said before. And I consider a plant hardy, meaning that you can just drop it in the ground and take care of it like you would any other plant and not have to do anything for it in the winter time. If you have to build a big cage around it and wrap it in lights and everything, how hardy is that plant? You get what I'm saying? That's not that hardy if you gotta, like, build a greenhouse around it. Maybe more hardy than, you know, like a coconut palm. You could never get away with that. Not without some extreme ingenuity and probably a lot of money. I still don't see that happening, but maybe. But with the windmill palms, they have that potential for cold hardiness. And I've had them outside before for up to 3 years, and then we had a bad winter where it got down to 13 degrees below zero. And I pulled them and moved them because I was like, that's not worth the risks of losing them with those types of temperatures. So I think that this is a good way to have them for me. I have others that are potted up and I enjoy them because that way from November through March, when all my other plants are inside, I can still have these out unless it's, you know, like I said, if it gets too cold, I'll pull them in. But where I live, we have some pretty cold days in winter, but it's usually mixed in with lots of nice days as well. It's all over the place where I am. Yeah, that's everything. Just a little, you know, chatty plant time, very last minute. Again, these will look better as they start to progress. I'll make sure to put pictures up on my social media, which is linked down below, and in the garden tours, which there will be one coming up, either one or two videos after this one. But that's only going to be like a 3-day difference from when this is filmed, so they probably won't look much better in 3 days. I don't know. We'll see. If anybody's grown these dwarf marguerite sweet potato vines, let me know. I'm interested to see what your experience is with them, because I have grown other dwarf sweet potato vines before, and they still got pretty dang big. But, I mean, 12 inches, that even if they got 24 inches, that would still be much smaller than a typical sweet potato vine. So hopefully they live up to that. Hopefully they live up to that. They'll stay nice and small. Comment down below. Just say hi. I love talking to everybody. What's going on in your gardens? You having a good week? I hope so. And don't forget to do the whole YouTube thing. Helps the channel a lot, and I appreciate it. Thank you so much. And yeah, I look forward to being able to give updates on these when they're actually, like, nice, full, and pretty looking. Okay, I'm gonna go now. Lots of other fun things to do in the garden. I hope everybody's doing well, having a great day and a great life, and everything's just going beautifully for you. And if not, that's okay too. Things are weird right now. Of course, as always, and most importantly, everybody, keep on growing. Bye bye. Real quick, I just stopped recording. Did want to mention, I know I said that everything in here was for part shade to shade. I know the sweet potato vines, these can usually go shade to sun. Their growth habit will be a little bit different depending on where you keep them. The same thing with the snow frost, what are you? Diamond snow euphorbias. They'll do well in full sun down to, I'd say, part shade. They'll do okay. Anything below that might be a little bit more scraggly looking. Okay, now, time to go. Bye bye.